The moon is one of the most romantic themes, mentioned in multiple ways throughout the history of literature and poetry. It's the favorite thing to stare at for lovers, and even art is full of representations of this beautiful object. Why are we so fascinated by the moon? Probably because it's the closest body to our Earth, the partner of our little home in the universe. It's the brightest object in the night sky, even if it just reflects the radiation emitted by the sun. In recent years, the moon has become a symbol of scientific progress. With the moon landing on July 20, 1969, the USA was established as the world leader of space exploration. The event was considered as crucial in the Cold War between the Americans and the Russians. Here's part of the 1962 speech from President Kennedy that stated the aim to reach this mysterious gray object orbiting around our planet. We choose to go to the moon. We choose to go to the moon. We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other things. Not because they are easy, but because they are hard. Because that goal will serve to organize and measure the best of our energies and skills. Because that challenge is one that we are willing to accept, one we are unwilling to postpone, and one we intend to win. And the others too. However, some skeptics don't trust the official version of Neil Armstrong posing the first step on lunar soil with his famous words. That's one small step for a man, but a giant leap for mankind. They think that the moon landing is just an incredible conspiracy built by NASA for the benefit of the USA. Opinion polls taken in various locations have shown that between 6% and 20% of Americans, 25% of Britons, and 28% of Russians surveyed believe that the crewed landings were faked. In 2015, the Italian astronauts Samantha Cristoforetti and Terry Wirtz had a very interesting interview in which the NASA astronaut affirmed, "We can only fly in lower orbit. That's the furthest we can go. How is it possible that we reach the moon if we cannot fly in upper layers of our atmosphere?" Some detailed explanations are surely needed to solve this problem, which might be connected with a strange radiation belt, named after an American space scientist working at the University of Iowa in the middle of the last century, discovered in 1958. Is the moon landing just a big hoax? How can we prove skeptics wrong? And what are these belts? What's their name? Why are they linked with the lunar Apollo missions? If you want to know more about these questions, stick with me, and I'll tell you everything in a moment. We'll try to dismantle the conspiracy theories later on in this video. Now let's focus on what Terry Wirtz intended as lower orbit. What is it? Is it placed between 300 kilometers and 1,000 kilometers over our heads? Is it the belt in which important structures orbit, like the International Space Station, ISS, the Hubble Telescope, and other satellites? It's not difficult to understand that if someone wants to reach the moon, he must surely exit from this lower region. And the Apollo missions went out from this area, indeed. Therefore, if we examine the trajectories of NASA rockets, we'll notice that there is something really strange. What? They decided not to follow the shortest path to exit from the lower region, but they made a longer journey. Why did they take this decision? Well, to explain this, we need to deal with something I mentioned before. They organized their trip to the moon in order to spend the minimum time in a region named Van Allen Belt. What is it? It's a zone filled with a great abundance of energetic charged particles, which usually come from the sun, which constantly generates the so-called solar wind. Have you ever heard about solar wind? Here's a simple explanation. The solar wind is a stream of charged particles released from the upper atmosphere of the sun, called the corona. This plasma mostly consists of electrons, protons, and alpha particles, also called alpha rays or alpha radiation, consist of two protons and two neutrons bound together into a particle identical to helium-4 nucleus. These particles are captured from the magnetic fields of planets, usually forming a belt that surrounds the rotating celestial body. When were they first discovered? In the 30s of the 20th century, an Italian astronomer, Enrico Medi, firstly started to study the possible existence of ionizing belts, practically areas which are filled with charged particles and ionized atoms. Unfortunately, in that period, Italy was under the fascist dictatorship that radically went against Medi's studies. Only in 1958, after the first space missions that followed the launch of Sputnik by Russia in 1957, an event that gave birth to the famous space age, the existence of this belt was confirmed. The main proof came from Explorer 1 and Explorer 3, which were two of the first satellites built by the USA. And the region took the name after James Van Allen, an American physicist working at the University of Iowa. His interpretations of the experimental results given by the space missions confirms Meddy's previous conjectures. Even if with the term Van Allen belts, we intend only the area surrounding our planet, similar regions have been found on other planets too. As a matter of fact, the formation of these structures is practically the same for every celestial body. The high-energy charged particles emitted by the Sun through solar wind are captured by the magnetic field of the planet, and consequently, they get confined in a precise region. But let's talk a moment about the terrestrial magnetic field. When we first had the idea that Earth could be a single giant magnet. In 1558, when the French Pierre de Maricourt wrote the famous Epistola de Magnet, in which he talked about the existence of the magnetic North and South Pole, unveiling the possibility of building a little magnetic compass. Later on in time, the British physicist William Gilbert made further studies on the compass, understanding that the reason of its functioning wasn't connected with the polar star or other space objects, but with the existence of the magnetic North and South Pole. However, the first rigorous theory about magnetism and its lines of forces was published only in 1832 by Carl Friedrich Gauss. Nowadays, we have understood that the magnetic field of Earth is like a giant invisible shield that protects our environment from possible tremendous external threats. Why is it so important? This field deviates a lot of radiation coming from our Sun. As a matter of fact, its form is strongly asymmetrical. It's thinner in the area between Earth and the Sun, while much thicker on the other side of our planet. Many animal species have evolved basing on the existence of this magnetic shield that isolates us from particular emission. And if this field disappears, the entire humanity and natural environment would be at serious risk. However, let's return to our problem. Scientists have discovered that the interaction of the magnetic field with solar wind usually generates some regions filled with high-energy charged particles. The shape of this Van Allen belt is really strange, similar to a big donut centered on our Earth. Scientifically speaking, this structure is known as a toroid, thinner at the poles and thicker around the equator. We can distinguish two main radiation regions. The first one is also known as the inner Van Allen belt and is located from 1,000 to 12,000 kilometers from the ground, whereas the second outer one is lighter and extends to 60,000 kilometers of altitude from Earth. The first devices that tried to measure the intensity of these areas failed as they weren't prepared for such high energy. The main concern regarding these belts has been the possible damage it can cause to a space mission. For a spacecraft moving in these regions, the presence of energetic particles might be very harmful. As a consequence of that, hundreds of engineers have thought about how rockets could be shielded by such dangerous radiation. Before finding out more about this, be sure to like or dislike the video, so that we can continue to improve and make these videos better for you, the viewer. Plus, be sure to subscribe to the channel clicking the bell, so that you don't miss any of our weekly videos. Given the fact that NASA reached the moon, these problems have been totally resolved by the scientists working in Houston. But something should make you skeptical. What is it? Have you noticed it? How can we justify Terry Wirt's previous statements? How is it possible that today we're not able to pass the Van Allen belts when we have already solved this task with older rockets and materials? How is it possible that modern technology can't achieve the same goal of 70-year-old devices? Is Wirt wrong, or is the moon landing just a big hoax? To answer these questions, we need to have a solid conception of technology. Modern devices are not necessarily able to perform the same tasks as older ones. Take quantum computers or electric machines as an example. Even if it is true that they're not so efficient as their traditional counterparts, the scientific community continues to invest in them because there's a general belief that they will solve more tasks and will be more useful. There's a particular period in which modern technology doesn't perform so well. Let's dive deeper into our case. Today's spacecrafts are not any more able to penetrate the Van Allen belt because the devices carried by astronauts are smaller and more fragile than before. As a result of this change in sizes and structures, the interaction with charged energetic particles turns out to be really harmful. Moreover, nowadays, the life of NASA astronauts is a major issue that NASA wants to preserve more than before, when the aim of the research was mainly political. As we previously said, the moon landing was mainly an achievement used to mark the prevalence of the USA in the Cold War against Russia. At that time, the goal was mostly to reach the moon before Russians, whereas nowadays other issues are considered more important. Returning to Ward's interview with Samantha Cristoforetti, it's necessary to underline the context in which his assumptions were pronounced. Before saying that we can't go higher than the lower orbit, he specifies right now. What does it mean? It means that even if we have already managed to get through the Van Allen belts, right now, with the devices we have built in order to achieve our main goals, we're not able to perform that previous task. Do you want to hear a really silly comparison? If we're in a Ferrari, we certainly cannot drive through a really ruined Roman road made out of big stones. Obviously, we have been able to move on that street for centuries with just a horse. But with the modern technology we have developed, we can't anymore. So it's really important to understand the context in which statements are usually made. Wirt's assumptions shouldn't be a sign of the great and terrible moon landing conspiracy, but just a consideration on our actual spacecraft technology. To end the debate, we can add a little detail that will surely clarify our opinion on this topic. The ISS often spends some time in the Van Allen belt without any harmful damage. As a matter of fact, these belts have the so-called sub-Atlantic anomaly that extends these regions to just some hundreds of kilometers of altitude, where the space station usually orbits. And do you want to know another case in which these particles reach lower levels of our atmosphere? The polar lights. This is another example that shows how our magnetosphere has not so defined borders, and the same variability is proper of the magnetic field itself, as researchers have discovered that it has inverted its polarity several times in history. Even these changes might affect our organism, which is very fragile but seems to be destined to further and further places and discoveries. That's all for this video. Thanks for watching, everyone. Did you find this topic exciting? Are you amazed by the existence of this ionizing belt? Are you excited by the different theories regarding moon landings? Have you ever heard about Van Allen before? Is there anything more you want to hear about the magnetic field of Earth? Let me know in the comments below. Be sure to subscribe, and I'll see you next time on the channel.